Good morning. I'm very honored to give a presentation at your conference on blue economy and green hydrogen. As my title is Green Energy for All from Morocco, but I will especially discuss the possibilities for hydrogen in Morocco. But let me start by showing you this graph. And this is a graph from IRENA where they show the very positive development of the cost to produce electricity by solar and wind. You see, solar photovoltaic over the past 10 years, it has decreased in cost substantially, but also for onshore wind. And today we see also concentrating solar power and offshore wind coming down in cost to produce 1 kilowatt hour of electricity. As you can see, the cost at the very good sites at this moment for solar, but also for wind, are about 1 to 3 cents euro cents per kilowatt hour. And if you see the gray area in this that is representing the cost to produce electricity with fossil fuels, with gas or coal, it's even higher than for today at solar and wind. That's the very good news. And the first thing people are always asking to me, but yeah, solar and wind, can it produce all the energy that we need in the world? And indeed, that is possible. And it is also a piece of cake, you could say, to produce all the energy for the world by solar and wind. Here you see that we use in the world about 606 exajoules or 168,000 terawatt hours. And 1 terawatt hours is 1 billion kilowatt hours. That's not the energy only for electricity, because that is less than 20%, but it is for mobility, it is for the industry, for high temperature heat, but also for the feedstock to make chemicals, for example, and it is for heating and cooling our buildings and houses. All that energy is that figure of 168,000 terawatt hours. And if you use 11% of Australia and put their solar panels over there, then you can produce all that energy. Or if you want to do that with wind and you put every kilometer a large wind turbine, you need 1.5% of the Pacific Ocean with wind to produce all that energy. So it's a piece of a cake to produce with solar and wind all the energy we need in the world. You can also do that with on the Sahara Desert. And the Sahara Desert is bigger than Australia. We need less than 10% of the Sahara Desert to produce all the energy for the world. So the Sahara Desert is a big energy resource, you could say, for solar, but also for wind. But if you look to the where can we do produce it very cheaply, then of course that is only at these regions where we have high irradiation from solar or high wind speeds, that is clear, but also where we have very low cost for the land that we can use. And if you look to these maps of the world, on the left hand you see the irradiation, the solar, on the right hand you see the wind, then you see at the dark red spots we have the highest irradiation. And look to the Sahara Desert in this case, you see that we don't have only very high irradiation, but we have also very high wind speeds in many parts of the Sahara Desert. So especially the Sahara Desert is an area where we can produce from solar, but also from wind at low cost, because there is also some space available at low cost. The electricity or energy, you could say, from solar and wind. But we have made a GIS evaluation. Where can we produce a sufficient amount of renewable energy, in this case from solar? It's called a heat map. And what do you do on such a heat map? You look to the solar potential to produce in a square kilometer, and you subtract the amount of energy that is used in that same square kilometer. And then you get areas where you have a surplus of solar energy in this case, and where you have a shortage. of solar energy. And the green areas, there we have a lot of surplus, which is also the Sahara Desert, as you can see in this case. And the red areas, we have a shortage. It's a projection for the year 2100 from the IPCC scenarios. And of course, we have not looked only to the potential for solar, because that is given by the solar irradiation map. But we have also looked to these areas that you can use. For example, you don't want to get to cut all the rainforest at the equator, for example, to put solar farms over there. So therefore, you see at the equator that there is not a lot of surplus production, for example. Also not in countries like Nigeria, but also you don't want to put solar farms at agricultural land. So therefore, the potential is restricted to these areas that you can use for in this case, solar energy. And then you see that there is a lot of shortage, for example, also in countries like India, but also in Europe, in the US, China, Japan, the Philippines, for example. You see also Indonesia. But there is also a lot of surplus, especially in the desert areas like the Sahara Desert, but also in Namibia, Australia. You see that there is quite some surplus in solar energy. Now, what does such a map show you? It shows you that we need to transport over large distances a lot of solar energy in this case, but it is the same for wind energy, to these areas where we have shortages. So transporting energy and storing energy so that we can deliver it at the right time, at the right place, becomes very important also in a renewable energy system. Now, let's go one step back, because this is about the resource. But you have to make from a renewable energy resource or from an energy resource first an energy carrier. That can be done by converting solar, for example, with solar PV into electricity. And that can be done also by wind turbines also to produce electricity. And here you see technologies that can produce the, the energy carriers that, when you use them, don't produce any CO2 emissions or any greenhouse emissions. And the only two energy carriers that can do this is electricity and hydrogen. Because when you burn hydrogen, you don't get CO2. Or when you convert hydrogen again to heat, you don't produce CO2, but you produce water in this case. Now, as you see, we can produce directly from solar and wind electricity, but we can do that also more or less directly from convert to hydrogen. And that are technologies that are now in the development phase. For example, you can directly use the photon of the sunlight to split a water molecule into hydrogen and oxygen. And you can also use kites to produce far at the ocean with wind electricity, but then you convert directly to hydrogen, and then you can store it and sail it, bring it to the shore at every place where you want. So you can use directly solar and wind also to convert that to hydrogen instead of converting it to electricity. But there are also other technologies where you can produce hydrogen and electricity without CO2 emissions. For electricity, that's well known. That is, for example, nuclear power plants that can produce electricity without CO2 emissions. But also for hydrogen, you can use natural gas. And then there is a technology, methane pyrolysis it is called. Then you superheat the methane, and then to 1,000 degrees or higher. And then the methane is split into solid carbon and hydrogen. The solid carbon is not CO2. It's not going into the air. You can use it as a soil enhancer, for example, and we need it a lot. So also we can produce hydrogen from natural gas without any CO2 emissions, which is very interesting also, of course. Now, what do we do and where do we talk a lot about? That is that we want to use the one energy carrier, electricity, to convert to another energy carrier, in this case hydrogen. And then the technology is electrolysis, I have to say. And what is done in such an electrolysis technology? Then electricity is put in water, and then the water molecule is split into hydrogen and oxygen. But you can do that also the other way around. You can use hydrogen in a fuel cell, and then you take the oxygen from the air, and then you have a chemical reaction where you get water as the waste product, but electricity is produced from such a fuel cell. So this is a conversion from one energy carrier to another. But you can also, as I showed you, convert directly from the energy resource to electricity or to hydrogen. But of course, today we are talking about hydrogen production, especially green hydrogen production by using green electricity from solar or wind or hydropower and put it in an electrolyzer to produce this hydrogen. But what is the point? Why do you want to convert electricity into hydrogen? And that has anything to do with the transport and storage cost of energy. And here you see that especially transport and storage in a renewable energy system will have a much bigger cost factor than in a fossil fuel energy system. You see on the one hand, transport of electricity by cables, storage in pumped hydropower, and on the other hand, you see hydrogen transport by pipelines and storage, for example, in salt caverns. But again, why do we want to convert electricity into hydrogen? Because we have much cheaper transport cost. Transporting hydrogen by pipeline is a factor of 10 cheaper, more or less, than transporting electricity by a cable. And when you look to the storage cost, it is at least a factor of 100 cheaper to store hydrogen in the underground than when you store electricity in pumped hydropower. Let me explain a little bit. And also why we can do that also very, very fast, because today we have a natural gas grid, but we can use this same natural gas grid also to transport the hydrogen. And that's what we see today. We have on the left, we see the gas pipeline system in Europe, but we see also in the middle that this gas pipeline system is already connected to the Sahara Desert, because in Algeria, they have large gas fields, and the gas is transported to Europe by pipelines via also Morocco, but also via Italy to Europe. And these gas pipelines can be reused, and that's also what you see on the right side. There is now the gas transport companies have made a plan that they want to convert part of the gas transport system into a hydrogen transport system. And in 2030, about 30,000 kilometers of pipelines must be ready for hydrogen transport, of which about half of it, 15,000 kilometers, is repurposed gas pipelines. And that is the picture that you see over here. And then they can import also already from Spain to Germany, but also from the North Sea to Germany. Also, they want to make a connection already via Italy to the Sahara Desert. But you can also transport, of course, not electricity, but you can transport hydrogen also by ship. Before you do, you cannot transport it as a gas, because then the energy density per volume is too low, so you have to convert it into a liquid. And you can do that in several ways. You can make liquid hydrogen very cold at minus 253 degrees below zero, but you can also convert hydrogen with nitrogen from the air into ammonia. And that is the major component of also the fertilizers. And that is a way that you can ship hydrogen as ammonia to other countries, but you can also bind it to another carrier For example, in this case, toluene, and then it is becoming a liquid, and you can reuse your normal oil tankers to ship it around the world. So all these modalities will emerge over the coming years also. But now about the cost. If you look to the cost to transport energy by a pipeline or a cable, then you see this graph. And that has everything to do with the energy density per volume and per weight. The cheapest way to transport energy is in the form of a liquid, for example, oil in a pipeline. Then 5 to 10 times more expensive is the transport of gas by pipelines. That can be natural gas, but it is also hydrogen as a gas can be transported. Then 5 to 10 times more expensive is transporting electricity by a cable. And the most expensive is transporting hot water in a pipeline for district heating in the northern western Europe, for example. And then the other thing is that transporting a gas by a pipeline and looking to the capacity, that is also a factor of, say, 10 more that you can transport by a pipeline than that you can transport electricity by a cable. And therefore, if it is fossil fuels or a renewable energy system, it doesn't matter. But worldwide, we transport liquids via shipping, but also by pipelines. Then intercontinental, up to distances of 5,000, 6,000 kilometers, you can transport liquids and gas by pipelines. But electricity is only a regional thing. You can transport maybe over distances of 1,000 kilometers, which is already quite expensive electricity, and very local, that is transporting heat or cold by a pipeline. And that's the system today, but that will be the system also in the renewable energy system. And that has everything to do, again, with the energy density per volume and per weight. Now about storage. Today, we store a lot of natural gas in, for example, salt caverns, but also in empty gas fields. And we can do the same with hydrogen. We can store hydrogen in salt caverns. And when you look to the right figure, you see that we have in Europe a lot of salt formations with salt caverns, where we have won the salt from these caverns. And you see also that the red dots are representing today the salt caverns where we store natural gas in these salt caverns. In the UK, for example, there is also a salt cavern where we already store hydrogen since 1972. So that is an old technology. It can be done in these salt caverns. We can reuse also the salt caverns that are now in use for natural gas storage. And when you look to the capacity of such a salt cavern, you can store about 240 gigawatt hours in such a salt cavern, which has a capacity of 1 million cubic meter. This is about 6,000 tons of hydrogen. The cost, and that's the next one. If you look to the cost to store, that has the same, say, you could say the same thing, also for the energy density per volume and weight determines a lot the cost for storage. For example, storing oil in tanks, yeah, that is almost nothing. That is an investment cost of maybe 10 euros per kilowatt hour of storage capacity. Storing, for example, hydrogen in salt caverns, that costs you about the investment cost of a half to 1 euro per kilowatt hour for the investment cost. But look to pumped hydropower, that is already a factor of 100, 200 more expensive. And so then you are pumping up water and you release it to produce electricity again. And for example, batteries are even a factor higher than pumped hydropower. And therefore you see the cost to, if you compare salt caverns for hydrogen storage with pumped hydropower for electricity storage, then it is easily a factor of 100 to 200 more expensive to store it in pumped hydro electricity than hydrogen in salt caverns. So conversion from electricity to hydrogen makes it possible to transport and store large volumes of hydrogen to bring it at the right place in the world at the right time. And that's why you do this conversion. Yes, so what is the major reason that we need hydrogen in a carbon-free energy system? That is to deliver the cheap solar and wind energy cost-effectively at the right time and place. And normally, you see the second reason is mentioned, to decarbonize hard-to-abate the energy use, but in fact, the first one is the most important. That means also that we have in the world will emerge an energy system that we will see the cost competition between imported or exported hydrogen with the regionally produced hydrogen, but also cost competition between imported hydrogen that is converted again to electricity with regional produced electricity. And you will see that, for example, in Morocco, you can produce very cheaply your hydrogen. You can export that to the northwestern part of Europe, for example, and then you can even convert it to electricity again. And you will see that it is in some cases even cheaper than producing the electricity by solar and wind in these regions, regionally at these places. Now, this is the more general reasoning why you convert electricity to hydrogen. But let's give you some flavor, and I've done only some preliminary studies for Morocco and some other places. But here you see the same heat map that I showed for the world, but now only for part of Morocco. And there you see that Morocco is blessed with a lot of areas where you have a surplus of energy production by solar in this case. That is the green areas that you show here, and can produce, of course, excess energy in hydrogen in this case, also not only for their own use, but also for exporting it parts of the world. So, and that is also at low cost because you have also very good solar resources, as is shown on the right side. But not only the resources is very important, it is also the cost of your land, but there are other parts that are very interesting. You need to store your hydrogen because your solar is an intermittent resource. And if you want to produce baseload hydrogen for exporting it, for example, to Europe, and to put it in a pipeline, you need storage. One of these possibilities is storing it in salt caverns, as I showed you already. And what you see on the left side is a map of the salt formations in front of Morocco, but especially also at the Essaouira Basin, also part of it is in Morocco. So Morocco is not only blessed with good, with cheap land, and with good solar and wind resources, but also with the possibility to create salt caverns to store the hydrogen. And what we have done is making an analysis. Where can you do that? That is in that area above Agadir. There you have these salt formations. You can create salt caverns over there. And what is then the cost to produce baseload solar hydrogen and transport that from Morocco to Germany by a pipeline that I showed here is connected to the European backbone connection. Now, you can discuss about the cost for hydrogen production by solar, but let's say that you can produce solar electricity for 1 to 3 cents per kilowatt hour. Then in the end, you can produce about the hydrogen for 1 to 2 euros per kilo of hydrogen. Then you store during the day when you have an excess of solar, you store hydrogen in a salt cavern for use in during the night to produce and in the end baseload hydrogen. And that storage cost is 0.1 to 0.2 euros per kilogram of hydrogen. Sorry. Then you put it in a pipeline, but then you can also put baseload hydrogen in that pipeline, and then the cost to transport it as baseload to, for example, in this case, Germany, is about over a distance of 3,000 kilometers, only 0.3 to 0.4 euros the kilo. So in total, you can bring it in from Morocco to Germany for about a price of 1.4 to 2.6 euros per kilo in Germany, which is 3.5 to 6.5 euro cents per kilowatt hour in hydrogen terms. So this is really a very interesting proposition because you don't have the cheap land, but not only the cheap land and the good resources, but you can also create your storage facilities for that. And let me give you another example. I'm involved in a project. Oh, sorry. And here you see that you can connect the pipeline directly to the European hydrogen backbone that is now created, going through Spain and bringing also to France, and then it goes up all the way to Germany. But you can do it also in another way, which is also interesting for Morocco. I myself, sorry, again, let me tell you one thing which is always asked. Yes, but we don't have the water available where we want to produce the hydrogen. We have done, I'm also involved as a guest professor at the KWR, which is the Water Research Institute in the Netherlands. We have done an analysis when we have to bring seawater into the desert over a distance of about 1,000 kilometer, and we look to the cost to transport it and also to bring back the brine. When you demineralize the water, you have a saltier part which you have to bring back into the ocean. Then you see that the cost for transporting that is about 2 euro per cubic meter of seawater. And then you need to produce it with a reverse osmosis process, demineralized water, and that is also at a cost of about 2 euros per cubic meter. So in total, the cost to produce demineralized water for hydrogen production is about 4 euro per cubic meter. But with 1 cubic meter, you can produce about 100 kilo of hydrogen. So the cost per kilo is only 4 euro cents per kilo of hydrogen, which is, as you see, is a couple of percent of the total cost of hydrogen production. So even when you have no water available, if you have to get it from the ocean, then it is still not very expensive. And if you enlarge that seawater pipeline, you can also make drinking and irrigation water, and then you can do then you can grow even crops in the desert if you want. But now the other thing. You can do it also in another way. And that is I'm involved in a project in Egypt where we develop a large scale solar liquid hydrogen plant. And that is in the Sinai Desert, which you see the location over here. And what do we do over there? We build 15 gigawatt of solar, and we pump up the water. We produce electricity with the solar, and we have the mountains nearby. So we have first at the Red Sea a very flat area, but then we have the high Sinai mountains. We make a dam over there. We pump up water. So we store the electricity, you could say, and we have a storage capacity of 350 gigawatt hour of electricity stored in this reservoir. And during the night, we use this to produce electricity again, and then we can put that base load into an electrolyzer, and then we have about 3 gigawatt of electrolyzers. But then we have base load electricity, and then we can also liquefy it, because for liquefaction, you need base load electricity in this case. And then we have 3 gigawatt of electrolyzers producing about 400,000 tons of liquid hydrogen. And then you can transport by ship this liquid hydrogen. And the idea today is that you do that in a very LNG type of ship. But we can do that in a different way. And we think this is a much cheaper way to do that. When we fill tubes that can be put into a container, then we can put containers on a ship, and then we have a normal container ship, and we ship it, sail it to a harbor, and then we unload on a truck, and then we bring it directly to the consumer by truck or by railway. And then we have door-to-door transport of the liquid hydrogen in these containers. We don't have to pump it into an intermediate storage at the harbor site. So this is an interesting way to transport liquid hydrogen from door to door to the end use consumer. But the same thing, and that is the interesting part, we can also develop in Morocco, because Morocco has not only flat land, but you have also high mountains. And of course, you have to do a lot of surveys to see where these locations can be found, where you can put solar and put also a pumped hydropower plant, or use some of your hydropower plants that you have already. But you have the similar conditions as in Egypt and Sinai. So you have conditions to store the hydrogen in salt caverns, but you have also conditions to store the electricity, and then you can produce both baseload electricity and also baseload hydrogen for all kinds of your processes, to make ammonia, for example, in the port of Yorf Lasvar, or to make hot briquetted iron at the steel plant, and transport not only the hydrogen and use the hydrogen directly, but also transport hydrogen products, you could say, all the way that you want, and use it also, of course, for your own economy. I think this is very interesting, to develop a more national-wide program. How could you develop your hydrogen system, not only looking to the good resources and the cheap land, but also looking to your transport and storage facilities that you can create in your country. Thank you very much.
What would be your recommendation, and do you think that also Ecole Hassania should be involved in the clean hydrogen?
I've looked into the website of the school, and I think all these disciplines, faculties that you have over there are very, very interesting to make also a large contribution to the development of a hydrogen economy. You have seen, I have showed you some GIS, the heat maps. This is a discipline that you have at the school over there. The electrical engineering. You have also a large transport, that is maybe a little bit different, also for ports. Very, very important. And so you have to combine all the disciplines. Civil engineering, I saw, is also very, very good part of this school. So all these disciplines can be used for developing the hydrogen economy, you could say, in Morocco. Especially this school is fit for this. And let's start by making an integral plan for Morocco. What can we do where in Morocco? Not only looking to the resources and the technology, but also to storage and to transport possibilities. Because I think it is very worthwhile to develop it in Morocco. And especially this school can help a lot in that.
What would be your wishes for the school for this 50th anniversary?
I think Morocco has everything in house to become one of the main countries in this hydrogen economy, but not only in the hydrogen economy, it's not only hydrogen itself, it is also all the derivatives. So ammonia, liquid hydrogen, but also the steel, the hot briquetted iron. That is all what you can make, and also a lot of chemicals, of course, in the country Morocco, and that gives you a lot of opportunities to develop your own country and industry, but also for export. And that's, I think, very, very interesting. And I guess if you do this properly, I think, for example, a country like Oman has a very good strategy in this. If you not copy, but learn from that, I think in 5 to 10 years you can be one of these powerhouses.